All right. Well, good morning and welcome to St. Mark Lutheran Church. It is good to be gathered and to be present to each other in the midst of God's house, God's spacious house, and enables us to spread out. For those of you maybe who have not been here since we have opened, the procedure for Holy Communion is a little different. We'll commune the lectern side of the church first. You'll come down using the side aisle, place your offering here. You'll receive the host, the wine, place it in the receptacle, trash receptacle. It sounds better than garbage can, right? And then head on down back to your seat using the main aisle. And then when we commune this side of the church, then we will commune the pulpit side of the church. That's how that procedure works. All of our greetings and the sharing of the peace will be, for the foreseeable future, will be verbal. So, word came to me, one of the nurses suggested, instead of bumping elbows, you could turn, go back to back, and rub against each other. It seems kind of strange to me. I know Chris Bauer was really into it, but that goes without. That goes without. You know, I've got to stop picking on him. I mean, really, no. In fact, I think I need to continue to do that. Absolutely. And then Galen Collins is next. I'll pick on you next week. All in love. All in love. Okay. Just a couple of other things. Next week will be significant for St. Mark in that it will be Roshell Onofrey's last Sunday with us. Roshell and Jack are fulfilling a lifelong dream. I don't know why, but they're moving to Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. I don't know why. I don't know what the obsession is with Saskatoon, but Jack said it's just too hot here for him. And he likes the idea of cold and 3 feet of snow. So It was either Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, say that three times real fast, or the villages in Florida, one or the other. So, but you know, I don't like these kinds of changes. In fact, I hate these kinds of changes. But the reality is the turning of a page, and I am comforted by the fact that Roshell and Jack have Michigan roots, and that's never going to change. It's like, you know, once a Michigander, always a Michigander, and their families, the bulk of their families are here, and so we will see them certainly during the summer months, because anybody with any common sense gets out of Florida in the summer. But anyway, and then Roshell will be back. Reagan is getting married in October, so we'll see her then. So we wish them Godspeed. But again, next week will be the conclusion of that. One other thing. People have asked me, they said, you know, what about First Holy Communion for our third graders? What about confirmation? And I have not set any firm dates, but I'm thinking at this point, September. Hopefully September. We won't be back to normal, but we will have made a few steps closer, I hope, at that point, towards what I would call the old normal, which I much, much prefer. So that's where we stand right now. So I think, very important. First of all, we extend our sympathies to Greg Finney, whose brother passed away this week. His funeral was yesterday. On Saturday, and then also a dear member of our St. Mark family, Janet Lipinski, passed away yesterday about 1 o'clock, and her funeral will be here Wednesday. We haven't set a firm time at either 10 or 11 o'clock, but as those details are firmed up, we will be sure to get that information out to you via our email chain, which gives me an opportunity to say, if we don't have your email address, get that to us. We're always happy to add more people to the list. So that is all that I need to share with you. Now we take this time to prepare our hearts to worship.
if anybody saw, I lit the candles and then I tried to blow them out like this. It doesn't work. I never said I had the highest IQ. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives all our sins, his mercy endures forever.
Amen.
God has given to all nations the repentance that leads to life. Let us come with repentant hearts to the God who makes all things new. Gracious God, we confess to you all the ways in which we dismiss the resurrection news. Foolish and slow of heart to believe, we turn from others and retreat in fear. Come into our locked rooms and breathe into us your forgiving spirit. Reawaken our trust and strengthen our hope that we may be witnesses to your saving power. Amen. Peace be with you, sisters and brothers. In baptism, you have received the spirit of adoption. You are God's beloved children. In the name of Christ, your sins are forgiven. Rejoice. Welcome this freedom as a gift.
Amen.
God of compassion, you have opened and brought us to yourself. Pour your love into our hearts, that overflowing with joy, we may freely share the blessings of your realm and faithfully proclaim the good news of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Please be seated. You know what? I didn't forget. Right before the service, I ran around wishing all of the dads a happy, happy Father's Day. I realized since that time others have come in. So I extend to each and every one of you again blessings for all that you do, for your witness, for your example, and God's richest blessings be upon you. And happy Father's Day.
Thank you. I say I will not mention him or speak any more in his name, then within me there is something like a burning fire shut up in my bones. I am weary with holding it in, and I cannot. For I hear many whispering, terror is all around. Denounce him. Let us denounce him. All my close friends are watching for me to stumble. Perhaps he can be enticed and we can prevail against him and take our revenge on him. But the Lord is with me like a dread warrior. Therefore, my persecutors will stumble, and they will not prevail. They will be greatly ashamed, for they will not succeed. Their eternal dishonor will never be forgotten. O Lord of hosts, you test the righteous, you see the heart and the mind. Let me see your retribution upon them, for to you I have committed my thoughts. Sing to the Lord, praise the Lord, for he has delivered the life of the needy from the hands of evil. Reading responsibly a portion of Psalm 69. Surely for your sake I have suffered reproach, and shame has covered my face.
I have found a stranger to my own kindred, and aliens to my mother's children.
Zeal for your house has eaten me up. The scorn of those who scorn him has fallen upon me.
I humble myself with fasting, but that has turned to my reproach.
I put on sackcloth also, and became a byword among them.
Those who sit at the gate murmur against me, and the drunkards make songs about me.
But as for me, this is my prayer to you, at the time you have set, O Lord. In your great mercy, O God, answer me with your unfailing help.
Save me from the mire. Do not let me sink. Let me be rescued from those who hate me.
Let not the torrents of waters wash over me, neither let the deep shallow me up, do not let the pit shut its mouth upon me.
Answer me, O Lord, for your love is kind, and your compassion turn to me.
Hide not your face from your servant, be swift and answer me, for I am in distress.
Draw near to me and redeem me, because of my enemies deliver me.
Second reading is from Romans chapter 6, verses 1b through 11. In baptism, we were incorporated into the reality of Christ's death and resurrection. We have been made new in Christ through his death and resurrection to live free from sin. Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in death like his, we will certainly be united with him in resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be destroyed, and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is free from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you must also consider yourself dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Here ends the readings. We stand for God.
Tell them the light. What you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not
kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I also will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I also will deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's foes will be the members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it. Those who lose their life for my sake will find it. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. And I did appreciate the fact that somebody wrote in my copy, all the hairs of your head are counted. And for some of the people, it's easier. That wasn't very nice. Rickey.
Daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's foes will be members of understand the kind of discipleship he wants from me. So if I am going to be a disciple of Christ under these conditions, I want to know, really know, that Christ has called me. So how do we know that God has called us? Do you remember the day you were baptized?
No.
Some of us do. Some of us don't. On that day, we were marked with the cross of Christ forever. We became children of the Almighty. Just as the early disciples realized that somehow God was inside them, directing them, making them able to do things they could not do before, we also have that same Holy Spirit directing and encouraging us. We have been called for a purpose. We are to do God's will. We are to be the law of love and forgiveness and mercy in this loveless world. Jesus is God's presentation of who it is we can be and are meant to be. We are to be a people filled with grace and compassion, a people who long for and work for justice, a people of mercy and faith and hope and love, a people created in the likeness of God. In Jesus, we see not only what it is to love the Lord, but also to be loved. Sometimes, however, our own weaknesses, whether they're spiritual, physical, or psychological, weaknesses that manifest themselves in many ways, such as seeing someone who is not like us and feeling those feelings of fear or disgust. These weaknesses get in the way of our mission. Our best at these times does not measure up. That is where grace comes in. We wait for that time when we will live in perfect faith. Until then, we must do our best as forgiven sinners to bring God's mercy to each person we meet. Only by the power of the Holy Spirit, who comforts us, coaxes us, challenges us, can this new creation come into being. Sometimes this happens quickly, sometimes it happens very slowly. However, we have a God who will not let us remain unchanged. He is the one who will constantly put before us opportunities for growth and renewal and change. But that change will never be complete until Jesus comes again. That change will always keep happening in us. That challenge will be before us daily until the day Jesus returns and makes us into the people he intended us to be. A pastor that I met some years ago, who wasn't pastoral, told me a story that truly gave me a visual image of what it means to be called by God. A young child had been playing in the aisle during a church service. As young children do, he spotted the open door that led to the busy street. He started running down the aisle, not knowing the danger that lay in front of him. Usher saw the child run toward the open door and very gently put out his arm to catch the child. It is God Almighty that sticks out his arm to catch us as we rush headlong to that busy street. That doesn't mean that God has my life or your lives all planned out. He doesn't tell you or me which jobs to take or what to do with our time. And if we follow that plan, life would be perfect. I don't believe God works that way, because God created us with free will and the responsibility of choice. We as Christians do believe that the Spirit leads and guides us to be the person God intended us to be. We are called to be the people of God, to spread His message of love, mercy, and forgiveness. He is is the one upon whom this church has been built. He is the one who will direct and guide this conversation, this congregation. The everydayness of life can sometimes overwhelm us. We often lose our purpose and our way. On the day of your confirmation, now tell me, you remember that?
Yeah.
You made a promise to love God with all your heart and soul and mind. That means that in every part of my life, I am to put God first. But every day life keeps getting in the way of that promise. That movie that really wasn't that bad. That language that everybody else was using in you. The act of unkindness of the cashier in the mall, running in the middle of that 12 miles. That driver who just wouldn't get out of the way so I could pass. That neighbor whose dog has to bark at daybreak every morning. That person who needs dirty dishes in the sink. The list could go on and on and on. At those times, and at many other times, God sticks out his arm to catch us. That is when he speaks to us through the hymns, the prayers, and the scriptures. Yes, God does speak to us. He does call us. Remember, Jesus has called his disciples, and he has called us. And he is the one who sent them out and is now sending us out. We have been given our marching instructions. Perhaps the cause of discipleship is not that we have to hate those we love, but we have to drastically change our own lives to reflect the mission God has for us. Perhaps we need to once more be reminded that this church was built on Christ and Christ alone. And we as individuals and a congregation have a mission to spread God's love and peace and forgiveness to all. This part of the gospel for today is a continuation of last week's reading. Jesus has called his disciples and now sending them out. This is their commissioning service. This is where they get their marching instruction. And today he is calling us to that same mission. We are the people of God, so don't be afraid. Go in peace and serve the risen Lord. Remember Pastor Olfrey's words to us? Be the salt and light that this world so desperately needs. Be the voice of reason. Be the voice of hope and forgiveness. Be the voice of reconciliation, no matter the cost. Amen.
Thank you.
our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed, which is found in the back of your book. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Sisters and brothers, we join our hearts in prayer. Our loving Heavenly Father, we pray for the church, for your church, for bishops and pastors, for teachers and prophets, for those who are newly baptized, and for those who are wise in faith, that all might be led to proclaim your power through lives of service and devotion to others. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Almighty God, we pray for the world that you love. We remember especially today the leaders of the nations, for regions of this world that are troubled by, it seems, unending conflict, for those who have been pushed from their homes, for refugees and prisoners who yearn for peace and for freedom. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of compassion, we pray for those who are in need this day, for those who are hungry, for those without home, for those who are oppressed, for those in prison, for those who are sick this day. We remember especially today Janet Robinson, Cynthia Gaffigan, and Gary Pelt. We remember Dennis LaPointe and Judy Zago, Jamie Nowicki and Lila Miller. We remember Patty Haslam, Nancy Milanek, those that we now name before you out loud or in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah.
Our loving Lord, we are giving thanks today for our fathers and for our grandfathers, for men who have been to us a protector, a provider, a guide in perplexing times, through whom we have experienced here and there and now and then grace and unearned love. Bless our fathers and our grandfathers. May we so conduct our lives today and in the days ahead that we might bring honor to their lives and their example. Lord, in your mercy. Eternal Father, we give you thanks for the great cloud of witnesses who have renewed the church's life throughout the centuries and for all people, and we remember especially today Janet Lipinski and Brian Finney, people whose lives have so enriched ours. Lord, in your mercy. And now in your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We share the peace verbally.
Thank you. Amstutz was not feeling well, so remember her in your prayers, and I guess I've got a double duty. Please stand. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. You have blessed us with your goodness. You have given us ourselves, our time, our possessions. May these gifts be used in the care and healing of all that you have made for the sake of the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
O God, our rock and our salvation, hear us as we praise. Call us to your table. Grant us your life. When the world was a formless void, you formed order and beauty. When Abraham and Sarah were barren, you sent them a child. When the Israelites were enslaved, you led them to freedom. Ruth faced starvation. David fought Goliath. And the psalmist cried out for healing. And full of compassion, you granted the people your life. You entered our sorrows in Jesus, our brother. He was born among the poor. He lived under oppression. He wept over the city with infinite love. Grant the people your life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Remembering his death, we cry out, Amen. Celebrating his resurrection, we shout, Amen. Trusting his presence in every time and in every place, we plead, Amen. O God, who are bread, send your spirit on this meal. O God, who are bread, feed us with yourself. God, who are wine, warm our hearts, make us one. God, who are fire, transform us in hope. O God, most majestic, our strength and our song, you show us a vision of a tree of life with fruits for all and leaves that heal the nations. Grant us such life, the life of the Father to the Son, the life of the Spirit of our risen Savior, life in you now and forever.
Amen.
Now, sisters and brothers, as our Savior has taught us, we have the courage to say together, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
The gifts of God for God's people. Holy things to make us holy. Please be seated. To those visiting, we extend a warm welcome. Please know here at St. Mark's, all of the baptized who desire to receive Christ are welcome at this table.
Lord have mercy.
Thank you.
Fix our hearts on your mercy and truth, that our lives may reflect your love for all people through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace. Be light in the midst of the darkness.
Thanks be to God.